गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
We're saying sorry that I'm late today because we had this paper party. Started at 12:30 and I thought by 2 o'clock it'll be over. But as sentiments are gets expressed, we all get, feel like saying something. She's been a colleague since 2005, so it's many years that she has been with us. There she goes, academically, officially from being a colleague. She's a former colleague. Professor Pankaja, was she teaching you anything?
No, ma'am.
She's a very good family law teacher. She's a very good family law teacher. Huh? She was teaching Parampara other sections. Very good family law teacher. And a very, very good person as well. For some of us are good teachers, some of us are good persons. And it's rare to find a combination of the two, good teacher as well as a good person. Very simple, very humble. Not a show off at all. I like her. So, okay, coming back to today's conversation is on Catherine Donovan's article. Did anyone read it?
Ma'am, I was not able to complete the entire thing.
That's all right, as long as you begin. Anybody else?
Ma'am, I did.
You did? Very good.
Yes, ma'am, we read that.
Okay, I'm glad that the set of people who are always prepared are still prepared. I will urge the other who have not been preparing to really start reading. It's high time. And because, as I said earlier also, if you read, discussion is much more interesting. You can raise new questions. Otherwise, I'll tell you what I understood about this article. So it's only one person's reading of the article, having just limited knowledge and perspectives. But when you read and speak, I get also new perspectives to respond to. Therefore, I insist. I know my always effort is that the students should read. So we do not spend the time in the class just me telling you what is there in the reading. I want us to start from how does the reading is relevant for us in our own life, in our statue, in our Indian context. So whether this means Tushar, Nirupam, Shreya, Mohammed Shakib, anyone wants to highlight any points which you found most striking?
Ma'am, what I felt was while reading the provocation part, yesterday your arguments for the defendant side were from that only, that you were saying the defendant would have said that more time, or in case of the woman, the more time could be considered for the provocation. So the sudden, the article was limiting the concept that it should be sudden, that we are saying a lapse of time. It was saying that more time could be also there for the provocation. Like in case of ladies, there is
Tushar, what's important, it is noteworthy that, which year is this article written? Have you noticed which year is the article? And we were looking yesterday, cases from 1960, when you look at Babulal, you look at other cases, Nanavati's case, all these cases where it's not that only, because at one level, we think that Catherine Donovan is saying something new. And that's what my understanding was also, that she had given us a new perspective. But having read her article, when I went back to Nanavati, I found that the concepts existed in Nanavati, the cases quoted in Nanavati. So, and I'm trying to locate the other cases we looked at yesterday. Which years are those cases coming from? I have lost the Nanavati. So Babulal is 1916. Baku is 1938, where this man waits and the judge says he was getting angrier. So 1938, the judges had recognized this concept of heating up rather than cooling down. Was Nanavati, and when you look at John Muhammad, 1929, 1958 is Narayan, Murugan is 1957. So from 20s to 30s to 50s, we are finding that the judges were aware of this concept called slow burn. Gradually you are getting angrier. So in this case, in all these cases, they were saying because of the previous instances, they were already angry, they became angrier on this particular point. So the concept of slow burn, they did not use this terminology. The terminology of slow burn is seen as a psychological, psychiatric condition, that she has lost her mind, you know, like depression is a psychological condition. Aggression is a psychological condition. Schizophrenia, psychological condition. So is slow burn. So women, in case of women, they never applied this whole concept of getting angrier over a period of time. But in all these cases, which are from 1929 to 39 to 50s, we are finding judges repeatedly saying, and in all these cases, the accused were men. In all these cases, judges said, this man must have got very angry, must have been in an angry state of mind because things were happening over a period of time. So something which was normally acknowledged in case of men never got acknowledged in case of women. And that's where we're saying that the manner in which the judge can relate to the man, and usually if you are a man, you're able to relate to the agony of the man a lot more because you might have gone through the same experiences. You do not know the other. And unless there is a generation of awareness, unless sensitivity is created, neither the men would know what the women are going through, nor women will know what the men are going through. What is women's experience of the world is also, we are subservient, men are superior. Men have to be respected. Pati Parmeshwar, you look at the names, the manner, even Pati. Karodpati means owner of crore rupees. So Pati Dev is also, one is Dev or also Pati, so he is also owning. So Swami, the very terminology by reference to which we refer to the men in the family indicate a superiority. Women accept it, men accept it. The whole law also looks at the human beings as men. So Catherine's article for me was very enlightening when I read it first time. So she is examining two of the defenses in our law. We have looked at one defense. We have still not looked at the second defense of private defense. Both of the defenses are gender neutral. This is whoever under the wise deprived of the power of self-control does this. So whoever is gender neutral. And what does this article tell us is that it took how many years, how many centuries before a woman sought the defense of sudden and grave provocation. So are we saying that 300 plus years, women never lost their self-control? And if they did not, then why were the men losing it? And why is it that the law has taken the male expression or male reaction to a situation as the norm of human conduct? So this article, in that sense, you know, takes on the conversation that when we are, what has been the life of women becomes an exception, the manner, the usual manner in which women react. All the cases we have looked under in Anavati are all cases of the wife being in an adulterous relationship and the husband losing temper and killing, including Anavati. Why are there no cases where women lost their self-control because the husband was in an adulterous relationship? Have we come across those cases at all? So are we saying only women are adulterous and men are not adulterous? What do you think? Why is it that we do not have cases of women losing self-control and seeking the defense of grave and sudden provocation?
Ma'am, fear of society, family fear, all that. Women don't have, they were not given that surrounding to express themselves, go to the court, go to the police or anything. That is a male thing to do. When they feel that something isn't correct, they go and take the help of the police and court. Women weren't, there are a lot of things like if they go and tell the court, they will be ostracized from the family and society as well.
The question I'm asking, Nirupam, that's a good response. That's one of the reasons certainly is that. But I also want us to ask ourselves that how do women react when they find their husbands in illicit relationships?
Ma'am, they usually compromise in these cases.
Right. So we are saying women compromise. Men kill. So what should have the law recognized as the reasonable human behavior? Compromising is reasonable human behavior, or killing is a reasonable behavior?
Compromising is.
But the law did not do that.
Ma'am, even in this article, it was quoted that the law takes this view that what is reasonable is only what a reasonable man would do, because the laws or the norms that were made generally by men. So they only had their side of experience and they overlooked the women's side of experience.
Mm-hmm. So what we are basically...
Ma'am, the thing I felt in this case, the categorization of reasonable man. Ma'am, when we look into the two genders, there's a lot of conflict. I mean, the thinking perspective is almost different, which was highlighted in this case. Like, a man always thinks logically. In the case of Nanavati, he was going to what should be the future course of action. He was thinking logically, which is not the case with women. They respond not logically, what they feel at the moment. They keep their emotions hidden mostly, and they come at sudden outbursts or some.
Okay, let me open this discussion to the whole class. How many of us believe that women are emotional, men are rational?
Ma'am, I don't believe this, ma'am.
Well, no, you have to kind of raise your hands to show me that how many of you believe that men are not emotional, they are rational, women are emotional. Only one hand up.
Ma'am, I believe it's the other way.
Men are not emotional. Men can also be emotional, but they are certainly less than as compared to women.
I don't agree with that.
Go back again. This killing the person when you find your wife in a compromising position, is that emotion or is that not emotion?
I think the emotions get the better of the men. That's why they act in a certain manner.
No, who is throwing acid?
Ma'am, men exactly men. get ahead of their emotions.
So therefore, their anger is not even seen as an emotional reaction. Because women cry, so crying is seen as emotional. Anger and killing people is not seen as, we're not even classifying. In our classification of what is an emotion, crying is an emotion. But getting angry to the extent of killing another one is not seen as an emotion, it's not classified, it's not defined as emotion. So somewhere our definitions are very, very gendered. And the legislation, which is gender neutral, is not looking at the fact that 50% of human beings do not get angry to the extent, they get upset, but not angry to the extent that they will kill the other. And therefore, any man losing his temper, seeing their wives in compromising position, should have got no exception. They should have been held for murder. Because that is not a human reaction. That is only a male reaction. And males should learn from the women. You need to compromise. You don't like it, get a divorce. You don't have to kill the other. If she has been unfaithful, just get a divorce. We have divorce as an option. So why do we go and kill the other? So if the woman, women will either compromise, or she will cry and go to the mica, or she will stand up with the husband. No, I stand with my husband, Shani Ahuja, Henry Clinton. Those should be their husband, the adulterous husbands. They didn't lose their temper. So is that a behavior to be emulated by human beings, all human beings, including men? Or whether to say, if men have been powerless over their emotions. If woman also loses it, she'll also get it. That's what the law is saying. Law is actually saying, oh, you can lose your temper because you're a human being. But 50% of human population doesn't lose their temper in the similar circumstance. Why is that not the norm? Why have we created an exception for a situation which is faced and which is done only by men? So in the name of neutrality of the law, we have actually protected men in distinction to the women, even though the law applies. So now let's have a scenario that a woman goes and kills somebody. There is a woman who carries a gun in her purse on a regular basis. So one day she went to meet her friend, a woman friend. And there she found her husband, the first woman's husband, having sex with her friend. She lost her temper and took out her gun and fired at both of them and killed them. Is she entitled to the defense of grievance and provocation?
Yes, she is. If men can take that defense, a woman can also take that defense.
Yeah, but reasonable women don't lose their temper in those circumstances. This woman did. So we have to judge her conduct by reference to how men behave or how women behave.
Ma'am, reasonable women concept is not defined at all. I think
law has always been saying this standard of reasonable man includes women. So therefore, now we're in a bind that when we are determining, because technically you are right, that if a woman also behaves like a man, she will also be entitled to. And as her defense lawyer, that's what I would want to argue. If I'm the prosecution lawyer, I will say no. She is not behaving like a reasonable woman. We cannot apply the same standard of behavior to her, which is expected of men, in constructing the reasonable man. We do look at the class, education, background, all these factors. We had a whole long list of things that we look at in constructing reasonable person. So the term we have been using is reasonable man. And the law does say, the language also tell us when we say mankind does not include women. That also is included. They're also included. So whenever we say man does it, we are not actually saying only man to the exclusion of woman does it. So therefore, our terminology language has been such that we have been using masculine gender for referring to human beings. And Catherine's article brings that out, that we have regulated the law, we have created the law by reference to how men react in a certain situation, what men will do in a certain situation. So one example has been this area of grievance and provocation. So all the cases that she refers to, all the cases are, every note from Duffy to all the other ones and all the cases we looked at in Anavati, they are all cases involving men as the person who lost self-control. And what are the scenarios in which they lost self-control? Wife in an illicit relationship. Why has it been that there has been no woman in that situation? So certainly there is one exceptional woman who behaves like a man. Whether we will judge her conduct by reference to how women behave in that scenario, or we will go by reference to how men behave. And that's a very, very difficult question to look at. That at one level, because it's gender neutral, and therefore we should apply. But that's not how, no. But that's the whole dilemma. That can we judge her conduct by reference to what should we judge her conduct? And in case of man and woman, we still have this very different reactions of how men behave and how women behave. Do we know how do the third gender behave? They also have partners, they also have families in their own community. So if they have this guru shishya parampara, so if a chela has to dish on the guru, gurus can get very angry also at times. So if a guru loses the self-control and kills the chela because the chela is wanting to leave the guru and go somewhere else, will we get the defense of private grievance and provocation? The binary has to now of course be broken, and we do recognize that there are other people who are neither men nor women. How are we going to determine their reactions, whether it is a reasonable reaction or it is not a reasonable reaction? If you do not ask the question of gender, then everybody who falls into the straitjacket formula reaction of the men, they will all get the benefit. But should we encourage people to take that under that violent behavior? Should be, you know, the moment we say this woman who was, you know, used to carry gun and kills, she's behaving like ordinary men, and therefore she should get. So what is the message we are giving to other women? Oh, you can also kill. Is this something we should promote? Allowing people to kill other, even the people who were not killing earlier. Now it is justified. It becomes public knowledge that even women they can also kill. So should they start emulating the men?
Ma'am, I think like you said that murder, when someone defends it and it comes under culpable homicide and the man is defended, it doesn't like promote in the society that, yeah, you can go and escape with it. It's only like most of the cases are not very publicized. If some are, I don't think that it promotes the feeling that, yeah, you can get away with it.
No, the distinction between culpable and homicide and murder and culpable homicide are not by reference to how men and women behave. But this particular exception is typically an exception, an exceptional behavior which men show. This is a typical reaction of men in a certain scenario. But it is presented by the law that this is a human failing. It's not seen as a good thing. It is seen as a human failing. But is it a human failing or a male failing? So something which is only a male failing, failure of the males alone among human beings, is presented as human beings are fallible. They do lose their temper. And if they lose their temper, they should be given an exception. So we say, yes, human beings are fallible. And there's no doubt about that. So human beings, the male human beings in these scenarios fail and cannot control their reactions. The female human beings are unable to control their reactions when it's a long-term violence. So should there not have been a defense available for that behavior also? We have recognized that men in this scenario loses their temper. Then we have studies showing women lose their temper in this scenario, which is a building up of anger. That's also human failure. But there is no law which says if a woman kills because of cumulative violence, cumulative anger over a period of time, there's no exception available for her. She has to behave like men in order to get the exception. But if she behaves like women do, then she must get a psychiatric report. So the ordinary reaction of women is seen as a psychiatric, a psychological malady, while losing temper suddenly is seen as human. While the first one, in case of women also,
the purview of the psychological thing you were talking about, that the woman is like insane or something is wrong with her, does it come under the purview of diminished responsibility?
Do we have any law which says diminished responsibility? We do not have anything. In Kiranjit Ahluwalia, this is the line they took in England. Kiranjit Ahluwalia, who was subjected to long-term 10 years of domestic violence. So on the date of the incident, she was threatened again that he will beat her up in the morning. So at night, she threw petrol on the man, set him on fire. He died a few days later. Charge was murder, convicted for murder. Then in the appellate court, the lawyers for Ranjit Ahluwalia took the plea of diminished responsibility due to slow burn syndrome. Slow burn syndrome is the psychological condition which is testified by a psychologist. So in order for the woman to get diminished responsibility, she had to take a medical route. But the fact that all women who will be subjected to domestic violence over a long period of time will get into this state of mind, it is not seen as normal human reaction. So if you lose your temper immediately, human. If you lose your temper after a period of time, cumulatively getting angrier, it's not seen human, this is seen medical. So by medicalizing women, they have been given the exception. And we were again saying that even in case of fourthly, when I was talking about excuse. So I was saying we can use this, but you can use this only by bringing medical evidence on board. In case of men, you don't have to get a medical evidence to say, oh, whether he lost his temper at that moment of time. Was he having, because what we call extreme anger is also kind of mental illness. But you don't have to get any reports for that. It is assumed that, you know, this is all happened, he's lost his temper. And it is normal for human beings to do that. You can regain your control later on. But the manner in which ordinary women behave, there is no exception made out to recognize they are fallible in these circumstances. And therefore, if they do fail in these circumstances, it will also be liable for culpable homicide because of the exception. But we have not created that exception. We have created an exception for the circumstance in which men lose their temper. The circumstances in which women lose their temper, no exception has been made. That's the point which Donovan, Catherine Donovan makes, that we are applying in the formulation of the section itself. We have not taken cognizance of the manner in which women respond to violence. Women respond to cumulative violence. Women's reaction to a certain situation. But what we have taken note of is how men, to the exclusion of women, react in a certain scenario. And that is presented as not only that, okay, any man, the section does not say, any man while deprived the power of self-control due to certain guilt provocation will be entitled to this. No, they'll be liable for culpable homicide. That's not what the section says. Section says whoever, anyone. So the section has been presented as gender neutral, but the actions covered in that scenario are very, very gendered. Only primarily men behave in that manner. So the point we are making is that when we look at laws, you will find it's not limited to only this one section. It is across board. In our feminist critique of the law, it is said that law is male. So when we say law is male, we are saying that when we define certain things, when we pick up a certain instance to make a law, we are looking at the experiences of men in their life, how they experience life, how they react to different situations in life. That has been taken as the standard of human behavior, and we have created norms for that. So the second example Catherine gives us is from private defense. So the basic principles of private defense are that certainly if you are under an imminent danger to your body or property or body and property of anybody else, and there is no occasion for you to take help, take recourse to the public authority, you can take action to defend yourself. And this action may extend in certain circumstances to even killing the other. So suppose if somebody puts a gun on your temple and says, part with all your money, otherwise I'll kill you. You have every right to snatch that gun and kill that man on that very moment. You are not liable for any offense whatsoever. In case of culpable, in case of exception 1, 2, 300, you are still liable for culpable homicide, not murder. But in case of private defense, if you kill a person in a circumstance in which you could have been killed, there was an apprehension, you can snatch that gun and kill him with that gun itself. He dies with the intention to kill you, kill because your motivation was to protect yourself. He has put a gun on, he has aimed a gun at somebody else, anybody else. that I am going to kill that person, you can still, you know, take out your gun and shoot him dead. So certainly, the right to private defense, so one is imminent danger, either to your person or property. So somebody has come to set your house on fire, you can shoot him down. Shoot him down. It's seen as a completely justifiable action on your part. This is called a justifiable defenses. So your action is justified. So in that one, the limitations are, one, you should not have the opportunity to take recourse to public authority. Second one is that the force you use should be proportionate to the extent of the danger. So if somebody is coming with a stick to, you know, a thin stick to beat you up, and you take out your gun and kill that person, it will be exceeding your right, because this is not proportionate. So the force used should be geared toward repelling the attack and not to take revenge. So if this feeble man is coming towards you, trying to beat you up, and you take out your gun and do that, so it should not be disproportionate to the danger posed. How much could this person could have harmed you? So proportionality is one principle. The danger should be imminent. So suppose there is Farra has come to you saying, tomorrow morning the Kabar Singh gang is going to come and loot your house. So then you do all the fortification of your house and get ready that when the dacoits will come tomorrow morning, I'm going to shoot them down. When you do that, and you have not reported the matter to the police, you're not entitled to it. So if the police station is so far off, there is no mechanism to tell the police, etc., so you have no occasion to take recourse to, you can actually fortify your house and shoot the dacoits dead. So the right to private defense is that. And that is available to every human being, irrespective of men and women. Seems very reasonable. Catherine's critique tells us that the circumstances in which men face this danger, sudden danger to their safety of their body or person, are very different than what women face. So what are the circumstances in which a man may suddenly face danger to oneself? It may be a riots are happening. You know, some suddenly riots have happened in the locality, or the dacoits have come, or somebody has accosted you on the road. So this will be suddenly. It is not that it happened today, it will happen tomorrow, it will happen day after tomorrow. Men do not face the situations of continuous violence. They face the situation of sudden violence. The law also says if there is a sudden apprehension, where the apprehension, actual beating is not required for you to exercise that right. So the section says when there is an imminent danger, apprehension of imminent danger, you can take proportionate force, you can use proportionate force to repel that that danger yourself. So if I'm sitting in my room at night working along 12 o'clock at midnight, and suddenly I found someone barging into my house through a window, an open window, my apprehension is that I might get flipped. I can shoot him down. There are situations listed: apprehension of rape, apprehension of killing. There are lots of listing there. We'll read those sections. So all those situations are there where you can cause death of the other person if required, in order to protect yourself. So if I do that, so that's one scenario. I am also protected. I cannot be charged for any offense if I do it in this scenario. This is a scenario similar to the males. So if a man is sitting at his house and suddenly somebody barges into his house and he feels that, you know, there will be a lot of robbery, there will be violence, he can shoot him down. Or he apprehends, you know, okay, this is, you know, he's a gay person and he thinks that these men have come to rape him, he can shoot them down. So there are situations in which suddenly the danger appears. Women face those danger as a group of people very exceptionally, because there are these men there in their households usually to protect them. But when the man of the house itself starts posing the danger on a daily basis, day after day, that is one third of the women, one third of the married women have faced domestic violence in their lives. And domestic violence does not mean it will happen just suddenly once. Domestic violence is a continuous phenomenon. Today, tomorrow, maybe 5 days later again. So there's a cycle of violence which happens in domestic violence. Basically, it's a cycle of violence. It's not that every day the husband beats. So one day, flaring of the anger will happen. The husband will beat her up or do whatever kind of violence he takes, the form takes. Then there will be a period of honeymoon where the husband will be wooing the wife, making her kind of say, no, I'm so sorry, this happened, blah, blah, blah. So period of honeymoon. Then there is a building up of anger again, frustration, anger, and then again blow up. That's how the domestic violence cycle continues. Women keep on hoping that this is perhaps the last time. He has apologized, now it will not happen. But it keeps on happening. So Karanjit Ahluwalia, after 10 years, know for sure that this violence is not going to stop. In those 10 years, she did approach to the police twice. She got a restraint order against the husband. He will not come near me. But nobody was there to enforce that. She has appealed to her family, she had appealed to everybody, but nobody could stop the violence to her. So in her experience of her life, domestic violence cannot be stopped and she will be subjected to violence tomorrow morning again. So it is not a sudden apprehension of danger, but there is a certainty of that harm coming to her life. The law provides no protection to her when she does self-help in those scenarios. So the circumstances in which women face violence on a long-term basis and then takes action self-help because nothing else worked. We have known women that when they are subjected to domestic violence, the first thing they will do is migraine. Then migraine wala, after some time, will cajole her, force her, push her to go back to the same violent husband. Nahin, nahin, ho jata hai, sahan karna chahiye, ladki ho. It will not happen. Pyar se samjha lo. All kinds of pressures are there for her to come back. She comes back. Same things happen again. She goes back. So this is back and forth 3-4 times. Then she knows that her Maika is also not ready to take her. Now she has the choices to make. Either to stay in this house and do something to prevent, stop this, or leave that house. Private defense does not require you to leave the violent place. If you have a right to be on that place. So she is rightfully in her matrimonial home. She doesn't have an obligation or a duty to leave the violent home. What she needs is stopping of the violence. So she's made complaints. Violence is still not stopped. So she feels, for her, it is a continuous apprehension of danger. It's not a sudden danger. It's a continuous apprehension of violence against her. So what should she do? What she does in private defense. Okay, then the second, so one is that the nature of danger she faces is different than what the men experience in their life, which is a sudden danger. She doesn't face sudden danger. It starts suddenly on one day, but after that it becomes a pattern. So she is aware that it will happen again and again, and it continues over a period of time. So she reaches a stage where she knows that nobody else can help her. This is a helplessness feeling also. She has learned that nothing works. So all this possibility that you would have asked a friend, you would have asked her family, you would have reported them to the police. She has tried everything, doesn't work. She finds only two choices at that point of time, if the violence is still continuing. Either kill herself or kill that man. In Krishna Luvalia, her statement is that she didn't want to kill him, but she wanted him to suffer pain. And that's why she poured the kerosene, the petrol on his feet, not realizing that it will result into her death. So her action in private defense was to teach him a lesson, to make him experience that what is the pain, bodily and emotional pain, this man has been giving to her over 10 years of their life together, married life. So her reason for taking the self-help was to teach him a lesson that he will learn, he will stop because nobody else would stop him. But all that, the fact that she waited for him to sleep, and this is a pattern, in domestic violence cases where woman had been subjected to long-term violence, she then stops and waits, either waits for the husband to go to sleep or he's very drunk. She does not take action when he's in full senses. That also is very different than what the law requires. Law requires that you should take immediately. You respond when the danger exists. So now danger is gone to sleep or he's too drunk. So in the legal terminology, legal requirement, he's not posing a danger now. When the woman takes the action, he's not posing a danger, he's sleeping. But for the woman, the mere fact that he's sleeping, for her the danger hasn't stopped because tomorrow morning the danger will wake up and meet her up again. So her experience of danger is very different than the manner in which law recognizes sudden danger, sudden apprehension, apprehension of imminent danger. So the experience of women in this scenario is not subject matter of the law. So when she comes to that scenario, she said that you will take proportionate, the force you use should be proportionate to the danger posed. So suppose the husband is beating her up. What should she do? She can hit him back. How many of you think that if a husband beats up the wife, the wife should beat him back? Got one hand up. So what do the other think? With this, she should not do two hands up. She should not beat up. What she should do? All those who are not raise your hands, she should just take the beating. Monica, what do you think? Okay, those of you who are saying she should beat him up, have you seen married couples? How do they look like? We have got Ram and Sita. Have you ever seen Sita taller than Ram? Anyone has seen Sita is taller than Ram? Or a couple where woman is taller than men?
No.
Very few. Yes.
Exceptional. So generally, when we are looking for our matches, even in our choices, men are looking for younger woman, slimmer woman, shorter woman, less educated woman, less income woman. So, and women are also looking for taller men, older men, more educated, more money. So we are married are hypergamous. Do you think that a woman with a 48 weight can beat up a 60 kg weight man? And also in the bringing up, men are brought up to fight each other as children. Women are not taught to teach to beat up each other. In my childhood, we have three sisters. My brother was very older, so we do not know what happened to him. But three sisters, we were not allowed to hit each other. Even siblings, one sister is just 1 year older to me, the other sister 3 years older to me. Neither my 3 year older sister beat me up ever, nor my 1 year sister older sister beat me up ever, nor I. So we were taught women do not fight. Do not beat her, do not use their hands. So suddenly you are faced with this husband who is taller than you, heavier than you, more trained in physical combat. Do you think you can really actually hit him without getting more bashed up? So it's very easy to say she should beat him back. But can she really physically do that? So her instinct of self-preservation tells her that she can do it when he's drunk. She can do it when he will be asleep. And when she uses her instinct of self-preservation, law says, oh, you were waiting and plotting. The law does not recognize that she is a human being with the instinct of self-preservation. Her reaction, his action are coming from that instinct of a human being. All human beings want to be protected. She also wants to be protected. And for her, the only way she can take action in self-help is only when the other person is less capable, because of the hypergamous status of marriages itself. But law does not take cognizance of that when it is proportionate. So if he's beating her up, she will, okay, can she take up an arm and you know, shot him dead. Women don't have access to arms. They have not used knives excepting for cooking purposes. She doesn't have weapons. She's not familiar with weapons. Today, girls are told that you should carry a chili gun. If somebody harasses you, you can use that. Will women be really able to use that gun? Or whether the man will snag that gun and put it back again on the woman? All these are the questions which law doesn't address. These are the experiences of women in relationships where they are subjected to day-to-day violence. So day-to-day violence, cumulative anger, these are the experiences of life of married women, even some of the unmarried women as well. So the experience, what the women experience in their life on a regular basis has not motivated the lawmakers to make a law to deal with their situation, saying diminished responsibility. If she has been subjected to violence and she takes revenge at that time, the article title is Battered Woman Who Killed, Defenses for Battered Woman Who Killed. So if they're a battered woman, so the fact, you know, and we saw this in Gyarsima, we saw it in Dhirajia, beating by husbands has been normalized. So if it is a normal action, what do you call that? The wear and tear of life. This is what judges say many times. So if beating by the husband is seen as normal wear and tear, and it's not only once or twice, it's a continuous pattern, the law still doesn't provide her any safety. Whether she has a right to her, you know, integrity of her body, safety of her body, and we say yes, of course, but what are the mechanisms available in the law whereby she can be protected against cumulative violence, continuous violence, repeated violence by the husband or the in-laws families? None. Complaints to, because hitting back is no solution, it becomes worse. I'm not trying to say that husband beating is good also. Ravi, you're right on that one. But experience of women has been that even after complaining to the police, the beating doesn't stop. The policeman will not be roaming around with the woman to protect her from the beating. So complaint doesn't get her any succor. She tried everything. She brought up Bicholia, she brought an uncle, she brought everybody to counsel this man. The harassment for dowry, harassment for not being English speaking, harassment for not being tall, harassment for not being white.
Ma'am, law is more in favor of women in today's scenario, I think, with 498A and all that. I mean, she can take...
498A. Nirma, have you looked at the language of 498A? 498A talks about a married woman subjected to such conduct as is likely to cause her grave injury or to drive her to commit suicide. So if a woman is given a slap here and there, do you think 498A is attracted? Whether a slap here and there amounts to grave injury, conduct as is likely to drive her to commit suicide? So what she faces, even in case of 498A, which has been meant exclusively for cruelty to married women, even that section does not take cognizance of what women face in their day-to-day life. It only talks about grave injury, conduct as is likely to drive her to suicide. So go back to Gyarsi Bai. She was subjected to whatever violence and she leaves and she tries to commit suicide. Do you think she can file a complaint of 498A? Judge will say, oh, at that time no beating had taken place. The conduct was not such as was grave. She has not suffered any grave injury. She committed suicide or she tried to commit suicide because she's oversensitive. You've got so many cases where the judges say even if the woman has committed suicide, she was oversensitive. So the construction of what is the conduct which can lead to a woman, which can result into her wanting to commit suicide, is also decided by the male gaze, by the perspective of men who think, okay, what conduct is likely to drive her to commit suicide? How do you determine that? So the language of this section, which has been specifically meant to protect married women from cruelty, is also couched in such a language that it actually does not provide women any safety against day-to-day violence. So then we have this film called Thappad, whether if the husband gives her one thappad, should she be entitled to get divorce? Is that scenario covered under 498? If no husband gives one thappad, can she file a complaint of 498 against him?
Ma'am, she can complain to Mahila Mandal and all that. They take care of every such trivial nuance which court may deem as not wasting the time of the court. But they will take into consideration of those and harass the family of the male to so that the women get a proper bargain in a family. They can take that measure.
So the husband, it was okay for the husband to beat her up.
Ma'am, I'm not saying that it is okay for the man to beat around a woman. I'm saying that they have...
Where is the law to protect her? Is it a right of her to go to Mahila Mandal? Do the Mahila Mandal have a right to enter her house? Can they enter her house? Or will they be held for trespass? We're talking about law. We're not talking about what support she can get. And how many women can get? How many cases have you ever looked at? How many complaints of 498 have been made when 1/3 of the married women are subjected to domestic violence year after year? In England, I was there in 1997, and there was a training program by police. In England, I'm talking about, where we think is Western country, advanced, all the women are working, they're all educated. The national average of making a complaint to the police was after 27 times of beating. National average, I'm talking about, in England. In a country like England, with so much education, so much of westernized equality being the norm, 27 times, only after that, the national said, a woman made her first complaint to the police. And the first complaint to the police does not mean that the violence stopped. But 27 times, they're still letting it go. So therefore, when we are talking about that the law as it has been provided for, it is providing for situations which men face in their lives. The law is silent in scenarios where women face violence. That's a small point we are making, and that's what Catherine Donovan is saying, that when we lay down the norms, the criteria, the definitions, we saw what do men do in that scenario? What are the circumstances in which men face danger? So that's the question we ask, and we created a law for that situation. Law did not take cognizance of the scenarios which women face. Take another example. Suppose you are a rich man, got lots of money, and you had pandemic coronavirus, lockdown happened. You have a family next to you who is very poor. They had no food, and they were dying of starvation. You gave them no food. Are you liable for any offense?
No.
Because the law is not made for those people who have no power. The poor family is not the... So what the law protects is your property must not be taken. So suppose this poor family enters your house, steals the food from your house. Law will say, oh, theft. It will put no blame on you who have plenty of storage in a lockdown scenario, but the blame is on that poor man. The law has been made from the perspective of people who have property. Law has not been made from the perspective of those who do not have property, who might be dying. There's a man who has been hit in a hit and run accident. You pass by, you don't stop. You're seeing that he's taking his last breath, he's dying. You do nothing, you just walk away. Does the law say, oh, you have done an omission, you should be held liable for doing an act which you knew, act would be an omission, likely to result in the death of that other person? Omission means legal omission, legal duty which you omitted. You don't have a legal duty, you have a moral duty. all the norms have been created from the perspective of people who had power. Whether power because of being men, power because you've got more education, more status, more whatever. So the experience of people who have things, criminal law is focused, is taking cognizance of those people. Criminal law is not about equalization. It is not about equity and justice, distribution of wealth. It's not all about that. It is only about status quo. Whatever is there, it should remain like that. So why is it that we have not made a law saying if you leave an injured person on the road without taking him to the hospital and you cross that street, that place, you will be held liable for his death? Why is the law not there? Why is there no obligation to save the life of your starving neighbor? So we have, and you will find these examples across. The moment you start looking at the law critically, you will find that it takes positions in the name of humans. But it is talking about certain kind of humans and not all kinds of humans. When the theories of state also tell us that at one, one perception of human beings was that all human beings are very selfish and all self-centered and they keep on fighting with the others. They're barbaric and brutish. The other perception of human beings are humane, they care for each other, altruistic. But both the groups of thinkers and then said that no, the state was created in order to have more stability, more regulation, more law and order. And it's called a social contract theory. So who entered in the social contract were propertied white men. Slaves were not human beings. Women were not human beings. Men without property were not human beings for the purposes of forming the state. So when the state, which has been created to treat equals as equals, so who were the equals? The white propertied men. So blacks were not equal, women were not equal, children were not equal, human beings without property were not equal. Even white men without property were not equal. So the law was made to protect the interest of those who made the state. So that theory also explains as to why do we have laws which are serving the interest of powerful people in the society. It was made by them only. That is where this whole conversation keeps on happening, that you need to have representations of different set of people when you're making the law. You must hear the parties who will be affected by the law. So when we look at the provisions, you know, when we come back to Donovan's article, so she says that when you look at the manner in which these defenses have been formulated, these are all taking cognizance of what men feel, experience, and react to in their life, ordinary day-to-day life. The circumstances which are faced more often by women are not subject matter of law. So today, 498 is good. 498 is a good example. Where
what I feel is, whatever you are saying, that a law is made for the rich man, a man with status and all, I think that is not the case. I mean, the people who made it were at high position, but the language which you're using is like the copy of the New Testament. It is written like whatever you are saying, that women and slaves were not treated as people at all. They should obey their master and all. And since we were given our law by the Christians, I think it is derived from that aspect. And as we know that till 15th century, the only subject taught in England was Bible. So how much perspective can such a country gain about what is right and what is wrong? So I think they made their rights and wrongs according to the teachings of the Bible.
I have not read Testament, so I do not know. What I'm talking about is that when you look at, when we say human being, and if I ask you to draw a human being, can you do that now? Draw a human being. Have you got any picture of who is a human being in your head? How does this human being look like? Everybody, please draw a human being. Take out your pen and pencil. Pen, pencil, notebook. Draw a human being. And after you've drawn the human being, describe to me what is the human being you have drawn.
A person with two legs, two hands, a torso, head, eyes, ears.
Whether this human being has any genitals? Any reproductive organs?
No.
So are human beings without them?
No.
Then how is your the picture depicts a human?
It is the basic caricature.
No, we are not talking caricatures. I said draw a human being. Can you draw a human being without it being a male or a female? If I ask you to think in your own heads, a picture of a farmer. What is the picture of a farmer in your head?
Someone wearing a turban and measly clothes.
In a male.
Beard.
Do we know that today farmer do the farming with tractors? Our picture of the farmer is still with a turban, with a hull, with a plow, with a two oxen. That's what we have. Huh? Centuries old pictures haven't changed. Even though the farming has changed today a lot. And also the fact that majority of the back-breaking job of replanting the rice is done by women farmers. You never think of women as farmers. Think of a jailer. Think of a thief. All these pictures are masculine in our head. But it's not saying that thief cannot be a woman, or a judge cannot be a woman, or a police cannot be a woman. Our whole picturization of the public sphere, what happens in the general field outside their homes. So when we talk about people doing different professions, whereas, when we do gender sensitizing programs, we do all these activities to find out that how our images of human beings are all masculine. So when the lawmakers and women, what is the appropriate place for women? Home. What is the appropriate for men? Work. That's how we have been brought up, and that's how we have seen the society around us. So if a child is sick in the house and both the parents are working, who is more likely to take leave for looking after the child is the mother. If not the child, even if there's a husband's father who is ill, the daughter-in-law will take leave. So caring work is seen as woman's work. Who cooks in your house? Women. Whether they are working outside the house or not, it is the women who are doing the cooking work. So we have divided the world into two for our actual day-to-day functioning. Law is made for functioning of human beings in the public field, outside the homes. There's been a recent phenomenon that law has entered the family sphere, and we got a Domestic Violence Act, or we got the 498A example. So where what is happening in the family? It's not that law had not entered there before. In case of adultery, the law was already there. If a man has intercourse with a married woman, then the offense is against the husband. So the husband's this is also a family sphere, that was happening to the married man or married woman. So that law has been made. But what was happening to the married woman in the homes, that law was not there. It's only recent entry. And we said that we do not allow law to enter the family sphere. In the public sphere, everybody is equal. So when the law is made for the public sphere is a place where most of the time, it is the men who are dominating. Have you ever gone at night on the roads at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock? And you will find only boys sitting on the tea stalls. very, very exceptionally on the campus, perhaps you will find some girl on the T-shirt. But on the main streets, you will not find women at 2 o'clock or 1 o'clock. The men are dominating the public sphere. It is their experiences of danger. You know, when a man is going on the road, if a woman goes on the road and gets raped, we say, what was she doing on the road? If a man goes on the road at night and gets mugged, we don't ask her, what we're doing at night, you know? Why are we there at 11 o'clock on the street? If you got mugged, your problem. But we say this to the woman, that what we're doing at 9 o'clock on the streets, you got raped, it's your problem. Both the actions are against the consent of the person concerned, but our reaction is dependent on who is the person there. Because women are not supposed to be, men are supposed to be, they should be going for work, they should be going for pleasure, they can go to the street for any work or no work. Women, in exceptional circumstances, can go, but then they do it at their own risk. So that is where the gender in law comes in. So law is making provisions for these men who, because of their responsibilities of work, have to be out on the streets. And if they're on the streets and they get suddenly accosted by a robber, then private defense. So that is the scenario law has in mind. Because law is only looking at what is happening in the public sphere. Law was not looking at what was happening in the private sphere, because that was seen as a place which is a place of love and affection, care, dependence, hierarchy, all that is accepted as normal family sphere. Men are there to provide protection to the women. And because men are there as the father, as the husband, as the brother, to provide protection, you don't need the law to come and protect you. That was the understanding. But when we found that these men in the family who are supposed to protect are actually becoming aggressor, there was no law. It was found to be not required at an earlier point, and that's why until 1983, we got the IPC in 1860. We got 498 in 1983. For so many, even for a century and 20 years, domestic violence was there, normalized. You don't need a law to deal with that. So somewhere recognizing that violence is happening at all places, today we recognize that, but the remedies provided are still not sufficient. So we have a Domestic Violence Act also, separate legislation is there. It is not a criminal remedy, which is a civil remedy. So we have been making laws, earlier gender-neutral laws, now gendered laws. But when you examine them closely, you do find that it still does not reflect completely the experiences of women. And that's the point which Catherine Donovan makes, that the law, the way it has been formulated, is formulated so that men can be protected. If women also find themselves in that scenario, they will also be protected. But the scenario in which women usually find themselves, there is no provision for them. And even when a provision has been made in terms of diminished responsibility, it has been medicalized response. Their actions have not been considered as normal. Something which men do, they lose their temper. It is not seen that it was a sudden attack of insanity. It will be seen, okay, no, he lost his temper. No, this is how human beings behave. But if she builds up her anger and explodes, we say, oh, she was suffering from a psychological condition. The only point we're making is that you have to become aware. Your generation of lawyers have to become aware of the critic of the law, critical legal theory, we call that. That you look at the law from the perspective of different stakeholders. You can look at the law from the perspective of the powerful. You can look at it from the perspective of whatever is the other. This other can be a community. This other can be a gender. So today, accepted categories are men and women. How many of us have normalized our association or our understanding of the other, the transgender person? You've seen hijras on the streets. What do you think about them? Whether you're thinking that they're human being equal and entitled to same respect, same opportunities. So the question which women started raising, now lots of other groups are also raising, and nobody has still acquired equality, the norm has still remained focused on the men. Now it's your turn to voice your opinions. And tomorrow, what are we supposed to be looking at after Catherine?
Ma'am, distinction between first and fourthly by some case.
Yeah, we have a case. So we will look at that case. But today, if anybody else has more reaction, these are, no, we do this in much greater detail, looking at different fields of law in our paper on gender justice in the fourth semester. But it is important to get familiar with the concepts at this point of time. It's going to become easier to comprehend because we have all this understanding of private-public dichotomy. We have the distinction between sex and gender and how sex also operates in guiding the law. Whether human bodies, because when you let minimum two kinds of bodies, we all recognize the female body with female genitals, female characteristics of body, and then we have the male body with its whole reproductive organs. So physically, these are completely different bodies in many respects. Some respects are the same, everybody got two eyes and two nose, etc. One nose, two nostrils. But then there are people who do not have eyes, who do not have ear, who may have a deformity in their face, or they may not have a hand. Whether they cease to be a human, whether the law takes cognizance of those people, we make all this, you know, this whole discussion about making special provisions for persons with disability. So who are the persons with disability? Whether we, I, you, who doesn't have a visible disability in terms of not having a hand or having a problem with walking or seeing, etc. Whether we are disabled, our construction disability is something which I can do but some other people cannot do. But the things which I cannot do is not disability. Can we see in the dark? We, the eyed people, can we see in the dark?
And to some extent, yes.
Yeah, so if there's no light, we need lights at night. The blind person doesn't need the light. So we have made provision for ourselves. We have created lights in every room because we can't see at night properly. This is not seen as a special measure for disability of ours. Our inability to see at night is not seen as a disability. It is another normal human condition. Therefore, we'll make lights. Can we fly? We have made, that's a disability. No, we cannot fly, the birds can fly. So we made stairs for ourselves to go up. That's not seen as a special measure. So we create definitions and say this is normal. This is disability, this is not disability. So if you have to create a ramp, we are very, you know, we are feeling very good about it. Oh, look, we are looking after those people. So those people we are looking after. But the fact that we have been looking after us as well is not a question, no? That's normal. So somewhere challenging our given, that what has been given, what has been told to us, may not be the only truth, may not be the total truth. There may be different angles to it. Is, I think that's what Catherine Donovan started for me. Something we have taken for granted, that this is how things are. She challenges us to rethink that what has been considered as human is not necessarily so. And this will keep on happening as we go along learning law. Some classes it will be more prominent, some classes it will not talk about. But once you become aware of it, yes. What's going on? Yeah. 2 minutes. Yeah, so that's what were we talking about? Got distracted by my colleagues.
Gender.
No, so what we're saying is that what has been given to us as normal has got lots of baggage behind us, and we're not questioned. We believe this is how life has been, this is how life goes on. But that means that is stagnation. There's no change.
Law is made upon generality, like upon that time, a hardworking man in high position was the generality. The England was like who have inhabited by the middle class.
Nirupam, we are in 2021.
Yes,
can that be a justification that why we have not changed the law till date?
Ma'am, I'm not.
It was made in 1960, and it is not only about that law. Even the laws we are making today, if you start examining them from the perspective of different stakeholders, you will find that there are a lot of what is considered as normal is actually the norms of a higher caste, higher class, more educated, more resourceful people. Even when you make law for the poor, there are inbuilt loopholes created so that people with power will not get entangled. As you go along, we are just beginning your education in this point of time.
Women today are educated a lot, so they can raise their voice in feminism and all that. A lot of population is poor, so laws are made for them. Like you said, for third gender, they're not in such high amount.
Nirupam, you need to You need to read those laws to find out whether really the Transgender Act provides anything for them. You need to read that. Just don't go by newspapers. We are studying these legislations in our gender justice course, and we find there's a lip service. If a transgender person is raped, you know what is the maximum punishment? 6 months. If a woman gets raped, it's minimum 7 years. So are we really protecting? We have to, that's where the critical legal thinking comes in. That just swayed by the political statements. And even the NGOs think, we have achieved something. But being a law person, you have to find out whether there are mechanisms established, whether they are really providing substantive relief to the parties concerned, can they really exercise the rights which were given to them? Can the woman go and file a 498 complaint on her own? What are the mechanisms available? That's why we need to have special police stations. So gradually, if you start talking about it, critically examining the law, you will find that there is a lot more needs to be done than what exists. And what exists, unless questioned, will continue to exist. Okay, everybody, put your attendance. We meet tomorrow and look at other exceptions in Section 300.
Thank you.
You're welcome.